We know there are many choices in internet radio, and the staff and host of LA Talk Live would like to thank you for choosing the internet's hottest destination for the most eclectic sound and invigorating talk. This is LA Talk Live. We are more than just talk.
It's Sunday morning, September 16th, and people are talking. This week, Los Angeles Mayor Antonio Villaraigosa came out in support for a proposal to use city library cards as an official identification, modeled after California cities like San Francisco, Oakland, and Richmond, an example of smart government or a self-serving overreach. We'll talk to the man behind the proposal, LA City Council Member Richard Arcone, momentarily. And it's no secret that California has the highest incarceration rate and rate of death row inmates in the country. Greg Akili, the Southern California field director for the Yes on Proposition 34 campaign, is telling us how we can repeal the death penalty law here in California while saving money and saving lives. Plus, the latest pop culture buzz with People Are Talking pop culture contributor Edward Jamile from New York, and our Sunday morning changemaker report featuring D'Artagnan Scorza of the Social Justice Learning Institute in Inglewood. People are talking right here and right now. Okay. So when he calls back, just put him right through. Welcome to People Are Talking, only on LATalkLive.com. I'm your host, Nicordelai Corte. Thanks for joining us. It's been a pretty exciting debut. We had an exciting debut last Sunday. All of you tuned in to LATalkLive.com, and we're so happy to welcome you back, where we're more than just talk here. Quite a week of things in the news. You know, first of all, on Monday, I went to a fantastic benefit, Cops for Causes event. It was terrific. One of our first guests, Christopher Landovazo, who's a deputy sheriff, he's also on the board for Cops for Causes, a fantastic organization. So if you're looking to support our troops here in LA and our law enforcement folks, check out Cops for Causes. They're doing good work there. Earlier this week, the iPhone 5. The iPhone 5 came out. I'm going to go get it. You going to go get it?
Yeah, I'm trying to get it.
Venerick, our board's op, he's going to try and get it. I see the beautiful star Coral's in the studio. You go get it? She go get it. She go tell you all about it on the dialogue on Wednesdays right here on LATalkLive.com, 5 p.m. Star Coral's in the house. Love her. In a bit of sadder news, you all may have heard about the death of our U.S. ambassador to Libya. Was killed in Libya earlier this week. Our condolences go out to the family of our fallen U.S. ambassador, some of his staff. Just a reminder that there's some danger in the world, and we've got to remain vigilant, and we've got to stick together. And a bit of lighter news, on Friday I had a chance to meet the very lovely Valerie Jarrett, senior White House advisor to President Obama. She is absolutely lovely, and seeing her is just a reminder that we got the right person there. So let's keep them there on November 6th. Let's do that. I want to say that, this show is supposed to be a meeting place. It's supposed to be a meeting place for us every Sunday at 10 a.m. Talk about politics and pop culture. It's really a platform where we don't just gossip about politics and pop culture news making headlines, but rather it's a platform that
offers us a little clarity to match our passion and conviction. So keep coming back to People Are Talking here on LATalkLive.com. I think we learn more about the world together than we do alone. So tweet me. I want to learn from you. Tweet me at Mr. Nicordalai, MrNiiQuartelai. Or visit my page here at LATalkLive.com/People Are Talking. Every week we plan to bring you a weekly discussion about politics and pop culture with fresh perspectives and really special in-studio guest. Yes. So moving along this morning, according to the Los Angeles Times report, the city of Los Angeles is considering a plan to provide library cards that undocumented immigrants could use as a form of identification. The cards would allow residents to open bank accounts, but they could not be substituted for a driver's license. Now, on Wednesday, kicking off the Latino Heritage Month, Mayor Villaraigosa honored some pretty incredible groups. Dream Team LA, Cheerla's Wise Up program folks, and the California Dream Network for their efforts in changing immigration policy for young people that were brought here to this country as children. Now, their lobbying helped to spur President Barack Obama's Deferred Action for Childhood Arrivals program, in which qualified undocumented young people would be eligible for permits to avoid deportation. Now, during the program, LA Mayor Antonio Villaraigosa said that he supports a proposal to use city library cards as official identification, although he had not discussed the cards being used for other purposes. So we're doing what we do best here at People Are Talking. We are getting a little bit of clarity. To learn more about what this policy entails and what it means for communities across the city, I'm now joined by Los Angeles City Council member Richard Alarcon, the main proponent of issuing ID cards. He submitted his proposal last month. It's currently being reviewed by the city council committees, and there's an opportunity for people to really shape what this might look like. And so please welcome the Honorable Richard Alarcon to the show. Council member, are you with us?
It's great to be there.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Well, you know, council member, tell us a little bit about your proposal to allow undocumented immigrants to obtain and use a library card as an official form of ID here in the city of Los Angeles.
Well, first of all, I think there's been a lot of hyperbole spun about. Essentially, it's to provide an ATM function, a debit card function on the library card. Ultimately, it could be used as an ID card, and I think that would be great. But the first phase of the process is to get the library system to recognize that many people in our community do not have the financial literacy to compete against insurance companies and banks and the contracting documents that are normal to our lives, and find themselves getting ripped off. The foreclosure crisis is evidence of that. The payday lending ripoffs that occur each and every day are evidence of that. We have 300,000 unbanked in our community, so the first step is to get the library system to pull together all of its financial literacy type information into a program that can serve those people who would need more information on credit, on interest rates, on how to buy a car, those kinds of practical issues. Then secondly, we would love to be able to provide an ATM function, a debit card function, and get the 300,000 unbanked in our community to start normalizing themselves by getting into banks and stop and for using services for free, as opposed to having to pay on average $700 a year for services that you and I get for nothing.
Now,
the third idea would be whether or not it could be used as an ID, and that's subject to the approval of the various authorities that would be interested in calling it an ID. Mm-hmm. But ultimately that may very well be true, but right now that's not where we're at.
Now, your colleague, Councilmember Mitch Englander, went on record saying, quotes, I'm concerned about the liability we would face as a government agency issuing a formal ID. He went on to say, could it be used to get on a flight? Could it be used to get into a flight school? He said that he wasn't comfortable with the city getting into an area, as he sees it at least, beyond its powers. He said that we should be concerned with fixing sidewalks and trimming trees, not issuing ID cards. How is your proposal not an overreach for local government?
Well, first of all, the city of Los Angeles has absolutely no authority to dictate federal aviation policy on who can get on an airplane and who can't. So the idea that somebody might use his ID to get on a plane is ridiculous. It's not a driver's license. It's not a pathway to naturalization. It's merely a library card. That if a bank wants to accept it as a form of ID, that's their option. If the police department would want to use it as an identification in minor incidences, you know, that's their option. But to suggest that the city of Los Angeles has the powers of the state government or the federal government is ludicrous.
Inquiring minds want to know, Councilmember, what is the estimated economic impact to the city of Los Angeles if your proposal passes?
In terms of cost, it shouldn't cost us anything because there will be a fee charged for, a cost-related fee charged for the access to the card and to the debit function. Not for the library card per se, but just for the debit card function. We would have to contract out with a bank. I would prefer a local lender or a local bank. There should be no cost related to implementing this program.
Is this proposed policy an example of sort of local government serving the interest of all their citizens, or simply, a part of the base of a very popular elected official like yourself?
I appreciate that, but I think that's hardly the issue. I think the real issue behind all of this is federal immigration reform. Mm-hmm. And obviously the federal government is not getting their act together in terms of giving us more clarification and clarity as to where we're going with our immigration policies. And so many cities find themselves, in fact, most cities find themselves in the situation of having an immigrant workforce that in most cases has a significant undocumented population affixed to it. So we have the reality of the economic pressures that our country relies on 12 million undocumented folks, and we have the local jurisdiction saying, wait a minute, do I want my people walking around with no ID, with no bank account, with hardly a way to identify them? Or do we have to take care of business at the local level and in the meantime help normalize people who are otherwise living in the dark?
Councilmember, I was reading that in the city of Los Angeles, there's an estimated 300,000 undocumented immigrants. I think you had alluded to that earlier. If your proposal passes, allowing them to open bank accounts, certainly local financial institutions are going to be hungry for that new pool of customers. You made big headlines earlier this year, late last year, related to the responsible banking ordinance that you got passed in LA City Council. How will that ordinance inform which financial institutions you might urge the city to do business with?
Yeah, it's interesting. You are pointing out an irony of the situation where I introduced the banking responsibility ordinance, trying to get banks to be more responsible and invest more to our communities. And at the same time, I am pushing for the unbanked to get bank accounts. And I don't see the irony in it at all. I think it is incumbent on banks to be responsible for their actions and do a better job of assisting our community with their own individual economic development progress. At the same time, we in order to be normalized in our society, you really have to be part of our economic system and bank. Otherwise, you become victims to payday lending institutions and check cashing institutions, which are charged egregious interest rates. So yeah, I've been a huge champion of the unbanked. I do want to clarify one thing. I referred to 300,000 unbanked. Not all of those are undocumented.
Oh, got it.
I mean, we have many kids that come out of high school and don't have a bank account and go well into their adult years before they get one. We talk about the 20s generation that is living with their parents. In fact, it's 30s and 40s nowadays, and senior citizens cohabitating. Well, many of them also are in tremendous need of understanding our financial systems better. And so it's not just targeted at the undocumented. It is targeted at, first of all, anybody who could use some financial better understanding of a financial situation they may find themselves in, or a process they're going through, getting a loan on a home, buying a car, getting insurance, all of those kinds of things that need to have a better understanding. Ultimately, I would like to see the state legislature pass a law that requires our school system, our public school system in the secondary ed, to start educating kids as early as middle school as to how to manage their financial affairs. But this is a specific thing that I've been working on with the mayor for several months, and we're very excited about it. We think it can alleviate a lot of the stress in those people who find themselves victimized on a regular basis.
Well, thank you, council member. I really appreciate having you on the show to offer this clarity. I mean, to sum it up, you know, this is the beginning of a process. This proposal isn't fully baked. It's still making its way through committee. There's an element of it that's about streamlining services, as I understand it. And so we look forward to having you back, as this proposal makes its way through the city council. Coming up, we're reading your tweets and taking your calls. Tweet me at Mr. Nicordelai right now. We want to hear your questions and comments about library cards for not just undocumented immigrants, but the unbanked people that don't have bank accounts here in the city of Los Angeles. Was Councilmember Alarcon persuasive? Are you feeling a little bit more comfortable or still a little uncomfortable about his proposal? Is LA doing the right thing? I want to know, so call me now. You're listening to People Are Talking only on LATalkLive.com. We'll be back after this. I'll just ignore it, but they keep saying.
Ladies and gentlemen, introducing Miss Margot Hudson and the hottest new love and relationship radio show,
Destination Love Life, where love and wellness come together as one.
Every Monday at 10 a.m.
Join us as we give the latest in love advice,
tips,
interviews,
news,
call-ins,
games,
and giveaways,
exclusively on LATalkLive.com. You can also catch us on iTunes Radio R&B or watch us on Ustream. Use your Android phone, iPhone, iPad, whatever you have, prepaid, BlackBerry, let's do it.
Destination Love Life, every Monday, 10 a.m. Reality Radio, handcrafted for your listening pleasure.
We are more than just talk.
Health, love, healing, laughter.
The Margot Hudson Way, every Monday, 10 a.m. Ooh, right in your ear hole.
Ooh, Rob, I like your brain.
I've never heard nobody say they want to suck on my intelligence.
Crazy. We'll see you there, everybody.
Hi, this is Susie Pruden. And yes, you've seen me on Oprah, Good Morning America, and The Today Show. And I'm inviting you to join me every Monday from 3 to 4 for my new show, Mastermind Live. Join us as we introduce you to the new thought leaders of the world who will inspire you, support you, and guide you to your next level. So don't forget to tune into Mastermind Live exclusively on LATalkLive.com. You can also catch us on iTunes Radio R&B or watch us on Ustream TV. Reality radio handcrafted for your listening pleasure. This is LA Talk Live, and we are more than just talk.
Hey, everybody, this is Richard Carr inviting you to join me in the radio boardroom for the new Entrepreneurs Weekly Summit in my all-new day and time. That's right. The new Entrepreneurs Weekly Summit is moving to Mondays at 5 p.m. Pacific. So don't forget, the new Entrepreneurs Weekly Summit, now Mondays at 5 p.m. Pacific, exclusively here on LA Talk Live, where it's more than just talk. We'll see you there.
Welcome back. Welcome back to People Are Talking, only on LATalkLive.com. I'm your host, Nicordelai Corte. You were just listening to Everyday People, Sly and the Family Stone, something to get you moving this morning. More coming up in a second, but I'm now joined with Greg Achille, the Southern California Field Director for the Yes on Proposition 34 campaign to really get rid of the death penalty here in California. Achille is also a legendary community organizer. He's worked with the United Farm Workers. I had a chance to meet you on the Obama 2008 campaign. Please welcome Greg Achille to the show.
Thank you, Nicordelai. I am loving this. This is something. I like this.
Great.
This is good.
Hey,
I like this.
Hey, if you like it, I love it. There we go. So, Achille, tell us how the people of California even came to support the death penalty in the first place.
I think two reasons. One, it was becoming, first of all, it wasn't working. It's a broken system, and it really hasn't functioned in years. Two, it's a costly system that, because it's broken, it's costly. And then finally, the concern about, could we execute an innocent person? Those three combination of things, I think, brought us together as a group of people who are concerned and said, this is something that we need to make a change about, that we can change policy here. We can join 17 other states, and we can join the rest of the democratic countries in the world that don't have the death penalty. So it was the combination of those three things. But I think focusing on the cost, the innocence, and a broken system is what really did it.
Achille, it's no secret that California has the most incarcerated inmates, the most folks on death row, I believe, in the world. How did this happen, and how is Prop 34 a potential way to fix it?
Well, I think there was the 80s, 90s, the crack scare, I think people were responding to so-called gang violence, and the knee-jerk reaction was lock them up and throw away the key. Just keep them away from me. And so that's what happened. So we wound up with large numbers of people in prison. We wound up spending an enormous amount of money contributing to the deficit of the state, and then it not working. Crime slowly went down because the economy got better, because more people got older, and a number of other factors. So now we have this huge prison population that's costing the state. We are trying to execute people that many of whom will probably die in prison, as most have already done. So we are at a stage where people are beginning to say, we need to take a look at this. We need to reevaluate it. We need to look at how we administer justice in this society.
And so for the people that are, you know, taking a hard look at this and looking at how to reform it, can you give our listeners a sense of, you know, who's supporting Prop 34 and who's opposing it and why?
I think the interesting people who are opposing it, the person who wrote the Ron Riggs, who wrote the initiative in 1978 that passed, is supporting Prop 34 because he is saying that it's a monstrously costly system that doesn't work. Representative Ron Heller, who helped pass the legislation in the assembly over 34 years ago, is now supporting Prop 34. The NAACP is supporting Prop 34 as a part of a national program that they've looked at in terms of mass incarceration, the death penalty, and the war on drugs. So those are just some of the people. Gil Garcetti, who prosecuted a lot of people and sent them to death row, is supporting it. And the former warden Garden of San Quentin, where death row sentences are done, is supporting it. All because, one, it doesn't work. Two, because you run the very real risk of executing an innocent person. And three, it could save the state up to $133 million.
$133 million
yep.
per year.
Yes.
Wow, that's a lot of money. We need as much as we can get, because otherwise it ends up in more taxes for the people of California. Now, the death penalty is often viewed as a third rail in politics. You got abortion. You got the death penalty, gay marriage, guns. It's one of those third rail issues in politics. What do you say to our listeners that sort of see both sides of the death penalty issue but are perhaps undecided this morning on how they will vote?
Well, first of all, I think it is the best example of a intelligent and progressive society that moves forward and really takes on issues that are so-called taboo. And this clearly has been one of them. Let's start with the fact that it doesn't work. The fact is we've had more people die on death row of old age than were actually executed. And there have only been 13 people executed on death row since 1934. And it's cost $4 billion to do that. That's $300 million per execution. So that hasn't worked. Secondly, we run the very real risk, as other states have done, of executing an innocent person. And none of us, I certainly don't want to be a part of that. And I don't ever want the state to be a part of that. And then finally, this system is simply broken. You can go to death row and be there for X number of years and not ever, the actual execution never happens. So a broken system, run the real risk of killing an innocent person, and the cost. I think those three combination of things, I say to people, give this a second thought. It's time to do away with it. We can replace it with life without parole. The people will, death row inmates will have to work and contribute to the victims' fund. And the money that we save can be used to solve rapes and murders that have gone unsolved for the past few years. So this is a win-win situation for the state. Mm-hmm. This is a win-win situation for the people of California.
Now, isn't there $100 million? Isn't there like $100 million fund that goes to public safety officers? Can you talk a little bit about that?
Yes. What this the initiative would do would establish a victims fund that the savings that we would be the result of eliminating the death penalty would go to. It's a 3-year fund that would be administered by the Attorney General, by Kamala Harris, for law enforcement departments throughout the state to focus on rape and murder cases. Here in LA alone, we've got 2,000 unprocessed rape kits. Now, some of that is, you know, because the state and the city are saying we don't have the money. Well, if you apply to the Attorney General, she will review your proposal and give you the money to do that. That'll be a 3-year program that will help solve crime and bring people to justice that have committed rapes and murders. So that's a good use of the money that we would save from not executing people.
We have a caller joining us. Caller, are you there?
Do you mind? We'll get anyone.
Oh, this is our pop culture contributor coming up, Edward Jamile. But back to you, Akili.
Yes.
You know, I have a feeling that this issue is pretty personal to you.
Absolutely.
Just a feeling. Can you tell our listeners why this is personal?
Well, since you asked a personal question,
yeah.
I don't believe that it's the responsibility of the state to exact vengeance on its citizens. I think that that's morally wrong and ethically wrong. So I've opposed the death penalty since it was instituted back in 1978. I've gone to San Francisco and stood out in the cold as people were executed in the early 80s. I've done everything I could to try to educate people and engage people about why we need to do away with the death penalty for the past over 30 years. So yes, this is personal for me. If this Proposition 34 had been in place, Stanley Tookie Williams would still be alive today. And I think that he is an example of why we need Proposition 34. He turned his life around in prison. He was convicted of a gangland shooting was convicted and sent to death row. He turned his life around, began writing children's books about the gang life, and became an example of what not to do, and was an articulate spokesperson for that. He would still be alive today if this Proposition 34 had been in effect.
Last question, Akili. In 30 seconds, can you tell us why this ballot initiative is an opportunity that doesn't come along very often? Right now, we have the repeal of the three strikes law. We have the repeal of the death penalty. You know, these are two issues that have contributed significantly, not just to our recidivism rate, but have contributed significantly to the incarceration of people of color here in California in very, very, very big numbers. Can you tell us in 30 seconds, why is this such a monumental opportunity for the people of California?
First, it can save the people of California millions of dollars. Secondly, we can make sure that we discard a broken system. And thirdly, we can make sure that we never run the risk of executing an innocent person for those three reasons. But nationally, where California goes, what California does, has an impact on the country. And ultimately, I'd like to see this country moving back to the point where we don't have capital punishment and we are not executing people and join the rest of the civilized world.
Thank you, Akili. Greg Akili, yes, of the Yes on Proposition 34 campaign, urging us to vote yes on Prop 34. Brother, thank you for your good work.
Thank you so much, and keep up the good work. I enjoy your show.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. Coming up, we're still reading your tweet, so tweet me at Mr. Nicordelai. I want to hear your thoughts on Prop 34. Did Akili persuade you to support the repeal of the death penalty here in California? I want to know what you think, so call me. You're listening to People Are Talking only on LATalkLive.com. Everybody's been so uptight and forgetting to live the life. Let all the problems get them down till it makes you want to shout. Oh, yeah. See, everybody's been down on luck. Now, finally, things are looking up. Chase all the rain away. No more obstacles in our way.
It's your boy DJ Deezy inviting you to join me every Monday night at 8 p.m. for our new show, Keeping It Real with the Cousins, exclusively on LA Talk Live, Monday nights at 8. You can also catch us on iTunes Radio or watch us on Ustream TV Monday nights at 8. Reality Radio, handcrafted for your listening pleasure. This is LA Talk Live, and we are more than just talk.
Hey, are you spending your time or are you wasting your time? Well, kill some time hanging out with Michael Kaya, Brooks Jackson, and the whole crew at the Michael Kaya Morning Show. I get up late. That's every Tuesday, 3 until 5 p.m. Pacific Standard Time. If you don't know what that is, you better get on the internet and look it up. And while you're there, go to LATalkLive.com and check me out.
Hey, what's up? It's your girl, Forbidden Gems, inviting you to join us every Tuesday night at 9 p.m. sharp for the hottest, livest talk show, Forbidden Tuesdays. Join us as we expose the new generation of love and dating and help y'all run a game right. Ladies, beware. Fellas, bring out your notepads. So don't forget to tune in to Forbidden Tuesdays exclusively on LATalkLive.com. You can also catch us on iTunes Radio R&B or watch us on Ustream TV. This is LA Talk Live, and we are more than just talk. You ready?
Hi, this is Starlet Quarles, and I'm inviting you to join us every Wednesday from 5 to 6 p.m. for a new show right here on LA Talk Live, The Dialogue, Real Talk, Real People. Join us as we discuss the topics that are relevant to today's generational leaders. So don't forget to tune in to The Dialogue, Real Talk, Real People, every Wednesday from 5 to 6 p.m. right here on LATalkLive.com. You can also catch us on iTunes Radio R&B, Live 365, Radio Flag, and now Stitcher Radio. Or watch and listen directly at LATalkLive.com. Reality radio, handcrafted for your listening pleasure. This is LA Talk Live, and we are more than just talk.
Oh, yeah, we're back. We are back. That is Whitney Houston right there. Tips him out. Wow. Legend. Legendary. Legendary. Welcome back to People Are Talking, only on LATalkLive.com. I'm your host, Nicordelai Corte. You were just listening to Greggy Keeley of the Yes on Proposition 34 campaign. Good brother doing great work as usual. Make sure you go to the Yes on Proposition 34 website to check that out. Now we are joined by our People Are Talking pop culture contributor, Edward Jamile, aka EJ. EJ, are you there?
I'm here. How you doing?
I'm well. How are you doing?
I'm doing well. Can't complain.
Welcome to the show. Welcome to the show. Now, I've got to say, I'm upgrading to Siri. I don't know about you, but I'm leaving the 4 for Siri.
I'm still torn. I'm not fully convinced yet, but, you know, I can't live without my iPhone, so either way, I'm keeping that.
I know. Well, listen, when Siri can schedule appointments, I said I would convert, and that is indeed what I'm going to do. You have some pop culture news for us, my friend. Is that right?
Yes, it is. It's true. Thank you for having me today.
Absolutely. It's time for our pop culture roundup with Edward Jamile. So what you got?
Well, I don't know if you've been watching, but Britney Spears is now on The X Factor officially. They've had 2 shows air this week. Have you been watching or no?
You know, I think I saw an episode where there was this weird, like, deranged guy that really couldn't sing, and he was like the biggest Britney Spears fan, and he brought out like a bouquet of roses, and you could see that she was visibly uncomfortable, and it made me feel uncomfortable.
I know. Viewers are feeling the same way. It's funny because they keep doing that to her. I don't know if you saw the first episode, but they had a friend of hers and a collaborator from the beginning of her career come on, and he was a little creepy as well. He looked very desperate and, you know, scary. She actually quoted saying, you know, I want to know who let you on stage. I feel very uncomfortable with you even staring at me right now.
Oh, Britney.
I think what's shocking about Britney right now is that people kind of expected her to be kind of musically out of touch, mm-hmm. and be a little bit aloof. You know, she hasn't had the best press over the last, you know, 5-6 years. So when she came out and had some really, you know, tasteful critique and some really strong opinions, people, I think, are really shocked that Britney is taking charge and claiming that seat that she earned on The X Factor.
So moving along, Nicki Minaj, didn't she announce her support for Mitt Romney? What's the deal with that?
Oh, that crazy woman. She, so basically, she is quoted in a song that she released recently as a feature on Lil Wayne's new album, or mixtape, and she's quoted saying, "I'm a Republican voting for Mitt Romney. You lazy bees are effing up our economy." But since then, due to all the backlash from her fans, which is pretty obvious, you know, considering that she has a large, you know, young following, as well as, you know, gays and women and African Americans, I don't think that, you know, that really sat too well with her fan base.
Yeah,
I came back explaining that was just sarcasm, and she apologized publicly to President Obama, and he actually accepted her apology and said something along the lines, I think, that she had a song out there, a little rap that said, you know, such and such about Mitt Romney, but she likes to play different characters, so I don't know what's going on.
Yeah, it was just kind of tongue-in-cheek, kind of fun. Moving on, Kate Middleton, there were some nude photos of Kate Middleton, the Duchess.
I feel so bad for her. Okay, so her and Prince William were on a private vacation, and during their time, some paparazzi were lingering in the woods and took photos of her and Prince William sunbathing. They were basically on a quick little getaway together, something romantic, and they took photos of them putting lotion on each other's backs, and Kate Middleton had no top on. She removed her bikini, you know, avoiding all those tan lines. And it's just kind of weird that this, you know, this French magazine, who
you know, before this scandal was at least a little bit faithful. Now they're putting a five-page spread showing the couple sitting outside of this private hunting lodge where they're clearly not looking for any attention. And you can see in the photos clearly that they have no idea that these photos are being
That's really unfortunate. I mean, this is a married couple, you know, and it's like, get over it, people. You know, why is this news?
You know, they should be happy that they're even happy enough to be away and, you know, go have some romantic time away from the public eye, but they just can't get it.
Yes, 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 yes. And finally, there's some news you have related to the Usher custody battle over his two kids. I guess the drama continues with his now ex-wife, Tamika Foster. Tell us more.
Yeah, they've been back and forth for some time now, fighting for custody over their two sons. And Usher's been, you know, relatively quiet and hasn't, you know, taken any public statement or interviews. But actually tonight, he's on with Oprah on OWN at 9 p.m. tonight discussing the trial over his two sons and the tragic death of his stepson. So it'll be the first, you know, inside look from Usher's point of view. So I'm kind of excited to see that.
Wow. So we got to make sure we tune into OWN tonight, the Oprah Winfrey Network, for that exclusive interview with Usher. That is our pop culture roundup with the Edward Jamile, our People Are Talking pop culture contributor. Thanks so much for joining us from New York.
No problem.
Coming up, we're still reading your tweets and taking your calls. Tweet me at Mr. Nicordelai, or you can tweet EJ at Edward Jamile, or you can call me right here at the station. Go to our page on latalklive.com. Tell your friends, tell your family, we're here, and yeah, this is just the place to be. When I return, I want to introduce you to a local change maker that gives me hope for the future, and after you meet him, he's going to pass it along to you. His name's D'Artagnan Scorza. He's the executive director of the Social Justice Learning Institute right here in Inglewood. More with him when we return, but first, I'd like to share our marathon song of the day. It's the song Our Generation by John Legend. This song is dedicated to the D'Artagnan Scorzes and Jamar Harris's, the Starlet Quarrels, conscious people of the world that inspire the masses. Keep doing what you're doing. You're listening to People Are Talking only on LATalkLive.com.
It's all left up to us to change this present situation. Take a lesson from our elders. Don't make the same mistake. Let's fill the world with love and get rid of all the hate. Our elders taught us one thing, practice another. Just look what happened to the Indian and the brother. It's all left up to us to change this present situation. Our leaders make us fight.
All artists, please send your music to me, your boy DJ Deezy, at 2livecrew@gmail.com. That's crew with a 3. Please send your Twitter, your song, and I'll add it to the segment for the bump of the dump it. And please let your followers know to support.
Hi, this is Lynn Kaufman inviting you to join me every Wednesday at 2 p.m. Pacific Time for our all-new show, Losing It Live. We'll share all the latest weight loss strategies, food news, tips for the holidays, travel, and we'll even talk about emotional eating. If you've ever tried losing weight and are still struggling, check us out. And if you haven't yet begun the journey to better health, tune in and let us help you. So don't forget to listen and watch us on Losing It Live, Wednesdays at 2 p.m. exclusively on latalklive.com. You can also find us on iTunes Radio R&B or watch us on Ustream TV, reality radio handcrafted for your listening pleasure. This is LA Talk Live, and we are more than just talk.
Hello world, how you living? This is D-Brex, your host of the all-new rap project here on LA Talk Live. That's latalklive.com. Or you can find me on iTunes Radio in the R&B section. That's The Rap Project, every Wednesday at 7 p.m. Pacific Standard Time. That's Wednesdays at 7 p.m. West Coast Time, so don't be late. On The Rap Project, I will be playing the very best of rap and hip-hop that goes beyond the ordinary. So connect with me, your host, D-Brax, the rap connoisseur, on The Rap Project every Wednesday at 7, right here on latalklive.com, where we are more than just talk.
Welcome back. Welcome back to People Are Talking, only on latalklive.com. I'm your host, Nicordelai Corte. Yeah, that's Chaka Khan. We're grooving this morning. We're grooving right here. I am so happy to make it to our Change Maker Report segment of the show. We're now joined by D'Artagnan Scorza. D'Artagnan Scorza, Executive Director. Yeah, you can clap for that. Executive Director of the Social Justice Learning Institute in Inglewood. He is an awe-inspiring local change maker, and we're so glad to feature him in our Change Maker Report this morning. Let's clap it up again. Okay. There it is. So, D'Artagnan, can you tell our listeners about the Social Justice Learning Institute and what really inspired you to create it?
Absolutely, and thank you for having me, by the way. You know, I grew up in Watson, Inglewood, and, you know, dealt with a lot of challenges in my life. You know, my father was on drugs, my mom had gambling issues, and at some point I realized that the experiences I had were not unique to me in my communities. And in many cases, for the youth in the communities around me. So what I decided to do was, after having gone to UCLA, come back to my community in Inglewood and do something about it, and realize that one of the populations that had the greatest needs were people who looked like me and were also young men, African-American males. And so what I decided to do was create a program that was focused on black males to help encourage them to set pathways for college, to improve their education, health, and well-being, and to mobilize them to create change in the community. And that led to the development of the Social Justice Learning Institute, where we work really hard to do all those things, right, and to advance social justice in our community.
Well, you know, that's really inspiring and so badly needed. You know, what's so inspiring for me is that looking at you as multi-talented as you are, returning to your community seemed like it was never really a big question for you. It was never really negotiable whether or not you were going to return to Inglewood. In fact, you teach over at your alma mater, Morningside High School. Can you tell our listeners why was returning to your community the right choice for you? Because, you know, for some people, it's not the right choice. And there's a whole host of different reasons. But, you know, tell our listeners, why was it the right choice for you?
Absolutely. And you know, it was when I was at UCLA, I graduated from Morningside High School in 98, and I was at the university and decided to study abroad. I went to South Africa. And when I traveled around to South Africa, I learned some really, you know, appalling things. First, that every one out of three people there had HIV or AIDS. I saw folk living in shanty towns where there are these aluminum huts and houses where there's not even ground, right? There's mud on the floor. And when I stood in Nelson Mandela cell, I realized that the struggles that I had experienced were linked to the struggles of those who were in South Africa and others around the world in South America, even in Mexico and places in our own backyard, right? And when I returned, I realized that that I wanted to do something about that. That had a significant impact on me. And I said, well, you know, I'm not South African. I'm not, you know, I didn't grow up in New Orleans where there are a lot of challenges. Let me go back to a place that is also, just as important, which is home, right? Where we call home. And so for me, I needed to find a place to start. And I realized that starting with my home was probably the best place for me to do that, with the goal of having an impact eventually on places like South Africa, right? So it was important for me to start with my family. I had two brothers, one who is now serving life in prison, and the other who was just recently arrested, as recent as June, who are both in jail, right? And so I realized that if I wanted to have any impact on these conditions, I needed to start with my family. And I needed to start with those who are nearest to me in my community.
Wow. That's pretty deep. That's pretty deep. Now, tell me a little bit about the 100 Seeds of Change campaign in Inglewood and how our listeners can get involved. I understand last year you all gave away like 300 fruit trees.
Oh, 1,000.
1,000. Yeah. I'm 700 off. Excuse me. 1,000 fruit trees to the folks in Inglewood. You've had a serious commitment to making Inglewood more and more healthy as each year goes by. Tell us about the 100 Seeds of Change campaign and how our listeners can get involved.
Absolutely. So when I first started this organization or these programs 6 years ago, our first group of graduates decided that they wanted to do something about conditions in our community and decided they wanted to be change makers as well and agents of change. And so they decided to start Inglewood's first community garden. And as a result of that work, a lot of community members, a lot of schools and local elected officials said, how can we help get involved? And as we started figuring out ways to do that, more and more community members and organizations wanted to build community gardens. They wanted to build their own school gardens. And so we decided that we needed to do something bold. We needed to have a big, hairy, audacious goal, right? Wow. And so the young men said, well, let's spread this work throughout the community. And as a result of partnering with some local community members who are now part of our team, we decided to build 100 school, community, and home gardens or urban farms as a part of a local food, as a part of a process to develop a local food system where we can share food in our community, where we can sell that food and at healthy and affordable prices, where it's high quality, it's organically grown, it's local, it has a great environmental impact. There's just win-wins all around. It teaches our children about health and nutrition. And that started because of these young men, right? That started because they realized they needed to commit to creating change in their community.
Shout out to the young men. You know, I've had a chance to not just meet with them, but work with them and really get to know many of them. And they are incredible. For all the folks that talk about, you know, the challenges that men of color are facing, young men of color, I think you need to go to the Social Justice Learning Institute and take a look at the great work that they're doing there, because there's something there, I think, that can be replicated and scaled up to more places than not. Now, switching gears a little bit, recently the Inglewood Unified School District issued some pretty deep across-the-board cuts to the district. I think it was 15% across the board. Now, in the darkness, I always try to search for the bright spot. Can you tell our listeners where is that bright spot for the people of Inglewood that are wondering what the future of education looks like for their kids?
That's right. I think Inglewood Unified is facing a number of challenges. And you're right. I'm a big fan of looking for the bright spot. I think 15% across the board cuts are a significant challenge, right? So I currently serve as the district sustainability advisor, and I've been working very diligently to help the district find ways to cut back on expenses and sustain resources. And so the district at some point realized that they needed to, as a result of declining enrollment, declining state revenues, they needed to really pare back on pay and salaries, and that hurt. I think that hurt a lot of people in our community. It hurt a lot of people outside of our community. It hurts our children, right? Because then they run the risk of losing teachers, good teachers. Mm-hmm. But what we decided to do, at least what I decided to do, was push forward and try to do something in support of our children. And as a result, we launched a campaign called Yes on Measure GG, and this campaign intends to invest in the future of our children by investing in the educational programs and facilities in the district, right? So there's been declining enrollment over the past 5 years. The Great Recession hit us. It's had a negative impact on public education across the country. But by and large, Measure GG is a way to move the future of our children's education forward. There's a focus on building and developing educational excellence. We're bringing in partners, corporate partners to help develop STEM programs. We're bringing in vendors who are focused on teaching environmental sustainability to our children. We're partnering with local community members who are just solely invested in educational excellence for Inglewood's youth. And I think that's going to help. I think it's going to help turn things around.
Wow. Well, you know, we'll certainly be learning more about the Yes on Measure GG campaign in Inglewood. I'm a proud, you know, supporter and team member with DART on that, full disclosure. Thank you for that. In 30 seconds, can you tell us what's next for you, and how can our listeners support your leadership? You're a pretty incredible guy.
Well, I appreciate that, and I have to say that the next thing is to scale up this work. I think you said it earlier, right? We've expanded to 5 sites this year. We're in 5 schools. We're at Roosevelt High School, Environmental Charter Middle School. We're at Hillcrest High, Morningside High, and now Augusta Hawkins, our School for Community Action, with some of my fellow social justice educators, and we want to go across the country. So in the next 5 years, our hope is to be in every contiguous state in the United States, doing these types of programs, working with men and youth of color.
People can go to which website?
www.sjli-cp.org.
Fantastic. D'Artagnan Scorza here, everybody, Executive Director of the Social Justice Learning Institute. Thank you, my friend.
Thank you for having me.
Well, that's all we have here today. Before we go, I want to make sure that I plug press conference that's taking place next Friday. It's taking place at the Leimert Park corner of Vernon and Crenshaw, September 21st at 6 p.m. to commemorate the execution of Troy Davis and ensure that Californians never execute an innocent person again. The California NAACP and other civil and human rights organizations and clergy are supporting Prop 34, and they will be a part of this press conference. And so let's make sure that we turn out and support the folks that are organizing to repeal the death penalty here in California. Well, that's all we're talking about today. I want to thank my guests for joining me, LA City Council Member Richard Alarcon, Yes on California Proposition 34, Southern California Field Director Greg Akili, People Are Talking Entertainment Contributor Edward Jamile, and of course, our Sunday Morning Changemaker Report featuring D'Artagnan Scorza of the Social Justice Learning Institute here in Inglewood. Thanks for joining us. Until we meet again, do what you can where you are with what you have. Don't just talk about it. Do it. This is Good Morning by Lenny Kravitz. Thanks for listening. We'll see you next week.
Get up, put your feet on the ground. Wake up to a nice cold shower. Good morning.